good to go.
Okay, good morning everyone. Welcome to OGGB3. Our first presentation for today is by Diego Biurrun, and he'll be presenting All Your Multimedia Are Belong to Us. Please make him feel welcome.
Yeah, thanks for the warm welcome. I will be speaking about libav and its twin sibling FFmpeg, which are basically the core engines behind most of the world's multimedia processing, hence my title, All Your Multimedia Are Belong to Us. So who am I? I started getting interested in free software around the end of the 90s, and quickly went downhill from then. I started working on Mozilla, then on MPlayer, FFmpeg, and I've been with libav since around 2011. So I've been in the multimedia free software scene for more than 10 years now. So I'm going to give you a technical overview about what libav is and its constituent libraries. Then we're going to look at legal issues that we had to face over the years, because multimedia is known to be a legal minefield. Then I'm going to talk about the split that happened in 2011 between libav and FFmpeg, and then we're going to take it to questions. So what is this libav FFmpeg thing all about? FFmpeg was started by a Frenchman named Fabrice Bayard in the year 2000. It's a collection of libraries and programs for all things multimedia. It contains a bunch of command line utilities, a Git repository weighs in at about 600,000 lines of code by now, and the whole thing is licensed under the LGPL with some GPL video filters. And by the way, the FF stands for fast forward, so that's a little bit of trivia for you. What does the libav community look like? It's mostly made up by volunteers, so it's very much unlike the kernel, where most of the people are professionals. There are some people that got hired or paid to do some work on libav, or back then FFmpeg, but mostly are volunteers. So, but what binds us together is that we, for example, we dislike C++, we like RC without the plus. We dislike non-C99 compliant compilers and auto tools. So that's why we didn't support compiling with MSVC for the longest time, and that's also why we have created our own build system, about which I will talk later. What we do like is speed. Multimedia processing is something that's very speed critical even today, and probably will in the future. And so we do assembly optimizations and things like that. We try to be standards compliant. For us that means mostly C99 and POSIX, and we also try to be portable. So we run on all sorts of different operating systems. You can compile us with different tool chains, etc. But for us, portability means that we program to POSIX and then expect the platforms to catch up to that, with some exceptions. This hasn't made us terribly popular with some BSD porters, but over the years it has proven fruitful, because we are very portable now, and didn't have to hack to litter our code with compatibility hacks. In the multimedia community, it's notorious for having a lot of abrasive characters and flames and things like that. And that's not to be denied. It's gotten much better over the last few years, but clearly, it's probably similar to the Linux kernel, or maybe in the past it was even worse. What we also have is troll-driven development, since most people are volunteers. It's hard to motivate them, but people still are proud and competitive. And so if you, for example, want to have some decoder speed improved, maybe you can find some Windows binary that does the decoding faster and show that to the developer that knows about that decoder, and maybe he will feel motivated and get trolled into actually implementing that.
You're a bit soft, so can you speak up?
Yes.
If not, can you just adjust the mics?
How about you and you? You can do that if you want to on the left.
So our goal is total world domination. For the free world, we've basically also already achieved that. So almost all free software multimedia is in some way based on one of our libraries. You all know VLC, GStreamer, MPlayer, etc. but also in the proprietary world, since we're LGPL, if you look at some shareware multimedia conversion tools, download them randomly or so, and check which DLLs they use, you'll probably find our libraries. But our most important services, our most important users are probably web services like Vimeo, YouTube, and Facebook that at this point probably handle most of the world's multimedia files, and they do use our libraries to convert whatever the users upload into the formats that they then present on the web. So this again is why I have chosen this title. So what do we have? We have three command line tools, avconf, which stands for unreconvert. This is a general purpose multimedia transcoding and transformation tool, so you can apply all sorts of transformations to multimedia files. We have a minimal SDL based player that we use for development purposes, so it's not a comfortable full-featured player, but it's just something that you can use to quickly view files and see if they have artifacts or similar. And then we have a AV probe, which is an analyzer tool that prints information about multimedia files. Then we have a set of libraries. I'm going to say a few words about each of them in turn. Libavutil contains our helper code, things like CPU detection, math, logging, things like that, general purpose data structures and data types. Libavformat deals with containers and network protocols. You've probably all heard of AVI and MP4, but there are very many other things that are supported. And network protocols, of course, only the multimedia related ones like RTP, RTSP, HTTP, ALS, that stuff. And yes, also Gopher. Yeah, I don't see much point in that. I tried and failed to win consensus to get that removed, so we still have Gopher support. So then there's libav device for dealing with hardware input devices like ALSA, X11, Video for Linux, things like that. We have libsw scale, which is a big eldritch horror that does color conversion and scaling. And it is a big blob of legacy, ugly code. Then there's libav filter, which has video and audio filters to do things like deinterlay, scale, crop video, apply effects, or maybe do channel and volume transformations to audio and also apply all sorts of effects. Then there's libav resample for audio resample and general rematrix thing, things like that. And then there is libav codec. So this is the big beast in our project. It contains a lot of decoders and encoders. Interfaces to hardware acceleration like VDPAU, VAAPI, several others, support for subtitle formats like SRT, ASS, that's ASS, not what you think, and it's basically the project's crown jewels. Show you why. So it contains about 130 audio codecs, so decoders in this case, and about 180 video decoders. So the ones that you will recognize are things like MP3, AAC, Vorbis, Windows Media Audio for audio, and things like H.264, MPEG-4, MPEG-1.2, Windows Media Video, etc. What we also support are lots of fringe formats. So in the 90s or early 2000s, practically everybody that had to deal with multimedia content in some way came up with their own format. And so there was a whole zoo of very specific fringe formats that were used, for example, in the gaming industry, only in full motion video cutscenes for some games. But since some of our old developers are gamers, gamers and like reverse engineering, they've implemented support for all these fringe and special formats in libav codec, in libav format as well. What we also have is architecture-specific optimizations to make things run fast, mostly for x86, ARM, and PowerPC. So we have a SIMD assembly with for 32 or 64-bit variants of these processors. So we generally have core routines that exist in C, and then some optimized variants that are written in assembly. And the way it works that at initialization time, we check for the CPU capabilities and the type of CPU, and then assign function pointers to the most optimized function that we are able to use on that CPU. And then at runtime, the code is called, or the optimized function is called through the function pointer. What we also have, unfortunately, is a lot of legacy spaghetti code. So in the old days, The FFmpeg back then code base was very monolithic. The MPEG, everything that deals with MPEG variants was all one big beast. There's the MPEG end context structure that is 308 lines still, and that is without comments, empty lines, or defines or anything. But we are also working on reverse engineering. For example, we had another big beast called DSP util that we've managed to eliminate last year. Then there's, as I mentioned, libsw scale, and we have things like that libav format depends on libav codec, which is not ideal because, for example, if you have to deal with hardware codecs, then maybe you want to use just libav format and don't have to deal with libav codec at all, and libav codec is pretty big. So, yeah, security is a topic that's come up a lot in the last few years, and, well, our security track record is not exactly stellar. Yeah, this has several reasons. The first is that we simply present a lot of attack surface because most of what libav format and libav codec do is input handling. So most programs have a small piece that deals with the input and then they have some large piece of logic behind it. For us, it's different. Basically, every decoder, every demuxer in libav format or libav codec is pure input, so there's lots of opportunities to make mistakes or overlook corner cases, etc. But on top of that, only recently have we switched to development practices that really care about error checking and these kind of things. So in the old days, speed was often favored over correctness. And if you go back 10 or 15 years, you maybe remember that it was really hard to get full motion video to play at all on computers of the time. So, yeah. But maybe it was a bad trade-off even then. We also use automatic tools to fix all sorts of bugs, like automatic fuzzers and coverity. But really, if you want to look for bugs, then you can mostly grab around, and you will still find a lot of things. But if our hearts remain pure, maybe we'll see the day that all our decoders and demuxers are robust. So the future. What will the future bring? In a way, so we are stabilizing and entering a phase of maturity because the multimedia world is moving away from this zoo of formats that you had in the 90s and early 2000s. And so hardware codecs are becoming more important, and we are focusing on refactoring and stability work. But still, for example, in this year, you will probably see DTH HD and GoToMeeting codecs added to libav codec. Yeah, if wishes were fishes, then I would cast a net for implementation of the Cineform codec, which is what the video codec used by GoPro cameras, a replacement for the libsw scale free beast, new hardware acceleration framework, and some maintainers that help us out because we're still mostly volunteers. I mentioned that we have a custom build system. It consists of a configure script written in POSIX shell and some GNU makefiles. It does dependencies, cross-compilation, you can switch between different toolchains, everything that you would expect from a build system. It's fast, so you don't have to wait 1 minute in order for it to tell you that nothing has to be recompiled. And it does actually work, unless other than most other custom build systems, which are mostly a bunch of non-working and things. This one does actually work to the point that I'm long toyed with the idea of making it a standalone project, but yeah, there's always the thing that it takes time and there's always so many other things to do. Another piece of infrastructure that we have built is FADE. FADE's first feature is that it has a recursive acronym as name. FADE stands for FADE, Automatic Testing Environment. At the moment, we have around 2,000 individual tests in our code base. Some of these are unit tests, but mostly it's actually full system tests. So for example, we would do a thing like decode a video sample from our test suite, convert each or generate a checksum for each frame, and compare that checksum to the reference that is stored in the code base. And so if you break the decoding, then probably some bits and some colors are going to be switched, and you will notice that immediately. So this has been very useful in finding problems, and has prevented literally thousands of bugs from entering the code base. We also have some clients that run regularly and just check out, pull the Git and compile and test, compile, run the test, and then push the result to a collector, which then aggregates all the results on a web page. And we also have a fate sandbox called Oracle, because the Oracle will tell you your fate, where you can push stuff and see if it passes the tests on platforms that you don't have at home. This is what it looks like. So the green bar in the middle indicates that most of the fate stations are currently green, so all tests are passing. Some are yellow, some tests are not passing, and the red ones are not compiling. So it's 8 architectures, 16 variants, 16 operating systems, 26 compilers, 262 configurations done by 11 contributors. So we run our stuff through a lot of different configurations. We also have a foundation, a 50133 incorporated in Delaware a few years ago, that sponsors development of codecs, optimizations, reverse engineering, and costs of infrastructure, things like that. Unfortunately, it has its non-profit status rejected last year by the IRS, as has happened with many other free software foundations, not the free software foundations, free software related foundations. So that is for the overview, and then we switch to legal issues. As I said at the beginning, multimedia is a legal minefield. There are many entities collecting patent royalties. You may have heard of the MPlayer LA and Fraunhofer for MP3. You may have heard for DTS and Dolby, AAC. There's a lot of reverse engineering that is being done, which is of dubious legality in many countries. There are trademarks, and there are also, especially in the past, there were very many murky copyright and licensing situations. So let's look at the issues that we've had to face over the years. Because clearly, we are all doomed and are facing jail time. So in the year 2000, FFmpeg was created and not really popular anymore. Same 2001, nothing much happened. 2002, 2003. Well, by the year 2004, we already did have some commercial users. So, but still everything was quiet. Until in 2005, finally, there was legal threat number one, and this is Mike Melanson, Multimedia Mike, celebrating the occasion on his blog. Do you have any idea how long I've been involved in multimedia hacking and reverse engineering? About 5 years now. All that while, folks have warned me sternly and constantly that this type of work would get me sued to death. I'm pleased to announce that today I received my first legal threat. I feel my work has finally been validated. So what happened? Onto Technologies, maybe you know that company because it was recently acquired by Google. Onto Technologies has been producing a separate line of codecs, VP3, which was the basis for Theora, VP4, VP5, VP6, VP7, VP8, and sold those codecs to their customers. For example, VP6 was used in Flash, VP7 was used by Skype, and at some point in 2005, they made a demo application for VP6 decoding as a Flash applet and presented it on a website. And of course, Flash applets are notoriously easy to reverse engineer. So somebody took that Flash applet, extracted the Java code, and converted it into a C++ library for VP6 decoding, which Onto did not really like. And so they sent those nasty grams to the people hosting the libvp6 library on their websites. So what happened was that all the people took that library down, but a few months later, somebody committed a native decoder for VP5 and the VP6 to libav codec. That was done on a Saturday, and I've some years later spoken to a person that then worked for Onto, our Google engineer, and he told me that on the Monday following that Saturday, they got wind about the decoder, but they never complained or did anything. So 2006, quiet again, same as 2007, and then 2008, finally something again, Nelly Moser. Nelly Moser is a company that did the ASAO, or also Nelly Moser codec, which is a voice codec, that was used in Flash. So if you recorded something to your microphone in Flash, then it gets compressed with Nelly Moser. So, and what happened there? Nelly Moser sent us a letter complaining that we were infringing their IP rights. Okay, so I answered them and asked what exactly was the problem and what exactly we were infringing, because IP is a loosely defined term, so were they talking about trademarks, copyrights, patents, whatever, and also which part of our code base? It was like 500,000 lines of code, it can't all be infringing, so what exactly were they talking about? And I asked them to be slightly more specific. The person promised to get back to talk to the engineers and get back to me, and indeed, a few weeks later, we received another email where they outlined that the problematic parts were Nelly Moser deck.c, Nelly Moser enc.c, and Nelly Moser.c. So basically, the Nelly Moser decoder, the Nelly Moser encoder, and the code shared between the two in libav codec. So I replied again, okay, so now we know which three files we're talking about, so this is much more specific, but still we don't know what the issue is. So is it trademarks, is it copyrights, is it patents, is it something else? And that was it. Never bothered to follow up. 2014. Basically, nothing happened. Wait, didn't I skip something there? Yes. In 2010, we received a letter from the MPEG LA. So that's the MPEG Licensing Association. And again, the tactic that we used was just ignore the letter, and it went away. Probably they had just had some new person starting there, and he or she was overzealous and found a new target to send a letter to, but really nothing ever came out of it. So, seriously, nothing ever happens? Well, so the point is that yes, there are legal issues in the field of multimedia, so this is not all completely made up, but there are some things to consider. For example, trademarks are easy to avoid, especially for a backend library like us. We maybe print some trademark to the console, so we can just disable that and print some other word or whatever. And the other point is that all these entities that go collect fees for their patents, they don't care if the software is proprietary or free and open source software. So so they don't care what kind of software you use, but what they do is go after the large commercial users, not after the providers of the software. So if you have deep pockets, and you use some sort of multimedia technologies where these entities have patent pools or whatever, then probably somebody will come knocking at your door. But if you're just a FOSS project that doesn't have any money and everything that you can get is a bit of bad press, if you try to sue them, then nothing would always happen. And just in case, there's also what we call the GB defense, and it goes like this. So if you receive a letter from some of these entities, you reply, "Je suis désolé, mais je ne parle pas l'anglais. Est-ce que vous pouvez traduire ces lettres au français, s'il vous plaît? Cordialement, Jean-Baptiste Kempf." For the non-French speakers in the audience, that means, hello, I'm sorry, but I don't speak English. Could you be so kind as to translate this letter to French for me, please? Thank you, and goodbye. And this also has worked in surprisingly many cases. So, in summary, don't be a coward, just hack. The copyright situation, let me say a few words about this. So libav is completely free software. It's licensed on the LGPL v2.1 or later. I did a full licensing audit of all files some years ago, and we found some non-free pieces, but these have since been taken out and replaced. And we've also replaced some GPL bits that we had here and there because we had wanted to have a simple, streamlined licensing situation so that people have fewer possibilities to make mistakes and run afoul of the license. So we come to the third part of my talk. You're probably all aware that sometime in 2011 there was a split in the FFmpeg project. Yeah, what happened? Well, by the end of 2010, beginning of 2011, generally the atmosphere and morale in the FFmpeg project was not in the best state. So people were unhappy because development was stagnating, patches were stalled, the leadership was dictatorial in a way and overly centralized, and many developers got frustrated and unhappy for very many reasons, so that by the beginning of 2011, some people had silently left or stopped contributing as much as they had previously contributed. And this led to these people gathering on IRC and noticing that they were a group of people that basically had the same impression, thought the same, and this led to the decision to fork the project. And so we spoke to more and more other developers, and at some point we noticed that actually the unhappy people were not just a few, but a large majority of the developer base. So at some point we decided to not just fork the project, but replace the old leadership with a new team. So a new Git tree was created. There was a declaration of independence, so to speak, that was signed by 18 developers, which instated the leadership team of seven developers and ousted the old leader, Michael Niedermeyer. So what was the result of that? Well, with the benefit of hindsight, it's easy to see, but it's probably best said with a picture. Yeah, somewhat unsurprisingly, the people that were not part of the crowd that decided to make changes in the project was not exactly happy because they had been left out of the decision, or because they were just not didn't have the same opinion. And they were a mix of shocked and angry, and this led to them starting a vote on the main development mailing list, in which was to be decided if the new team should remain in place or if the project should move back to the old leadership style. The seven people voted in favor of going back to the old leadership style, but what nobody was told was that this vote also contained sort of a call to action afterwards. So, I can speak again. I'm going to call them the revolutionaries and the loyalists. So the loyalists had received control of the ffmpeg.org domain from Fabrice, who was no longer active since maybe 10 years, but still maintained the trademarks and control of the DNS. They set up a fresh project server and new infrastructure, and then changed the DNS to point to that new infrastructure, then effectively splitting the project, taking the name FFmpeg with them, and the revolutionaries kept the old infrastructure, switched the name to libav, and moved to the libav.org domain. So, what has happened since then? So both groups of developers have stayed largely separate. They run separate projects with different policies. Development speed has picked up in general. So it's definitely not all been bad. There's a lot of bad blood still, but somehow people are also working and working effectively. So how do the projects look like today? LibAV is organized as a community of equal peers. It has a strict review principle, so everything has to be seen by and approved by four eyes. You need approval to push a change to the main repository. There's a code of conduct, and the general goal is quality and long-term maintainability of the code base. You can often find libav developers at events such as these, as well as on IRC and mailing lists, etc. Libav makes no public statements about FFmpeg or the fork or whatever. FFmpeg is still run by an evil overlord, so this is not meant as an insult, it's an old in-joke. It merges everything from libav and also from other sources. The mailing list is run more with a free speech kind of style, and the main development goal of FFmpeg is to add more features to the code base. The developers communicate mostly by mail, also a bit by IRC, and are only rarely found at events such as these. Unfortunately, although this has gotten slightly better at the end of last year, there have been very many public insults for libav and libav developers from the FFmpeg side. Yeah, my personal opinion about the situation, well, there's the Linux Conference Australia 2015 Code of Conduct, which says that language which is not appropriate for an all ages audience cannot be used in presentations, so I'm not complete liberty to speak here. So I would say that the general situation with FFmpeg and libav is that, and also, and butterflies, roses, ice cream. So I fear that we have to live with long-lived forks for the time being. I don't see the projects. So development style is very different. The culture of the project is different. Some of the people are not very compatible with each other, and this, if it should heal at all, this will still take a long time. So, before I take it to questions, I would say that we always welcome patches and new contributors. So, if you're interested in free software multimedia, then by all means, come talk to me. Go to a mailing list, to IRC channels, whatever. And what we also need is paid maintainers. So libav is notoriously understaffed, and it's really a very central piece in the free software stack. And it's a pity that there's so few funds directed at it. So if you work for a company that uses in some way, then maybe get in contact and help us fund some developers. So, questions?
Okay, we'll start here.
You've said that the FFmpeg project merges all your changes. What about the other direction? How much of the code from FFmpeg do you merge since the split?
So the libav to FFmpeg direction is 100%, so FFmpeg merges everything. And the other direction, so from FFmpeg back to libav, is cherry picked. So not all changes that land in FFmpeg get picked up by libav.
Next question.
Yeah. So two things. Firstly, you were talking about the fact that it's input that's controlled by third parties on the internet, most of the content. The formats are complicated. The buffer overflows are potentially possible. And then you talked about a test regime. Are you running any fuzz testing on the decoders to get some idea of what potential problems there might be that we can find before the third parties do?
Yes. Yes, there's fuzz testing going on. So Google also does fuzz testing for libav and FFmpeg. The problem is that there are just too many bugs. So it's at the moment the situation is a bit like Stalin said for deaths. So one death is a tragedy, and a million deaths is a statistic. And for bugs, it's a bit similar. So if you have one bug, then you want to fix it. If you have 1,000 bugs, then maybe you go see what's on the TV. And so it's a long and tedious process, yeah.
Many of these are surely, though, a class of bugs.
Yes, many are a class of bugs, but it still takes a long time to fix them all. So to fix all, just basically going in there and fixing all the mallocs is just checking that all the mallocs are, all the failing mallocs are caught is something that hasn't been done yet and is a lot of work. And it's not exactly the most fun and rewarding work.
I believe last year that Google put in about 1,000 bug fixes into the code for AV and FFmpeg. Can you comment on that in terms of did they just put it into both or did they put it into one and then it got merged? And also, have you had any contact with Google in terms of, obviously they must have people are looking at the code quite extensively in terms of maybe getting one of them to help as a paid developer on the project?
Yes, they're not helping with paid developers or so. So we managed to also get access to the Google cluster FOSS samples and results. We're not exactly happy with all the fixes that go into FFmpeg. We try to be a bit more thorough in many cases, and so it's a slow process. We also find that not all the things that get fixed in FFmpeg actually apply to us.
Two questions. One is very quick. Does the libav project receive donations from the public, or are there any plans for it?
Yes. Well, you can donate through the FFmpeg Foundation, or okay. through VideoLAN and things like that. We could get better in this way, finding ways to accept donations. I think it's not terribly easy right now. Does that answer your question?
Yes. And the second question is slightly more technical. You mentioned in your slides that libav format and libav codec are, they have a dependency in there.
Yes.
Have you also thought about maybe all the legacy codecs that are probably not going to be used in the future to be pushed to some different library that you can leave out at compile time if you so choose?
The build system is fully... fully modular and configurable. So at configure time, you can select, you can turn on and turn off all components. So you can build libav exactly to your liking. So you can just compile in two or three codecs, or you can just turn off two or three codecs just as you want. So, but we're not going to remove the decoders for these formats. So because libav codecs or libav is also about dealing with these legacy formats and probably preserving a bit of history. So in many years, these files will still exist and we will still have a way to play those files from the 1990s. So it's kind of a preservation of multimedia heritage.
What do you see as the next big thing for libav?
The next big thing for libav, well, we'll see in what direction the general multimedia world moves. So things that we added recently is a native HEVC decoder and a VP9 decoder. If you've seen the talk about DALA, hopefully we'll see some movement in that direction, and maybe DALA will be able to compete with HEVC and VP9 at some point in the not so distant future. I believe there's going to be much more importance for hardware accelerated codecs, things like that.
So unfortunately we've reached the end of the session. But just before we close, Diego, we have a small gift to say thank you for your presentation today. So thank you very much.
Thank you.